is Gregory Papanikos. I'm the president of this World Association of Academics and Researchers, and I'd like to welcome all of you to this city, the cradle of democracy, they call it. And I have to say a few words about democracy, just as food for thought. And that will be one part of my opening remarks. The second part will be something about our association, what we are doing, because a lot of people, they do not really understand our role, and they think that we are here only to organize conferences. And third, I'll say a few words about the logistics of this event. And hopefully I'll finish much earlier than the time that was allocated for my presentation. So this is, but of course I'm gonna go slow because my name means fast. I speak very fast, but I'm going very slow because unfortunately not all people speak the excellent English accent that I have. So this is a problem. So I have to go slow. It's like the 19th century British English, hockey they called so. And I have to go slow so you can understand my accent. There's another reason why I have to go slow. It's because we have people that their first language is not English. And they, and I appreciate if the speakers that they speak no other language but English, they go slow as well. So our idea is to communicate. And of course, most of the communication does not take place inside the room, but outside the room. As you can see, the space that we have outside this room is much larger than this space, and with nice tables and arrangements, so we can continue the discussion without being pressed, having the pressure of presenting, especially the young, they know what I mean. Now, the motivation to say a few words about democracy is because you come to Africa. Everybody identifies the city-state with democracy. But there was another motivation, because last November we had this excellent president from the United States that came to Greece in Athens in November, and he gave an excellent speech about democracy. Actually, he copied a paper that was written during his years at Harvard by a professor, and the title of that paper was Why Should Americans promote democracy in all other countries? They think that democracy is something like feta cheese. You can produce it, you can package it, and then send it to someone and sell it. It's more than that, and since what I'm saying, I have to be very careful when we use the word I here, that I say that. John Stuart Mill said something, he wrote an excellent many excellent books, but about democracy, and he didn't say it actually represented democracy, he said representative government is the title of the book, but inside the book he used the words representative democracy. So President Obama, that he will be remembered as a nice guy, but as an incompetent president, as someone said it in the United States, he gave a speech about democracy, but he was scared to go to PNICA to give the speech, and this shows something. So he didn't have the freedom to go and speak where the ancient Athenians spoke during the democracy. Now, I make an argument, it's very strong though, that democracy was an exceptional political system, even in ancient times. Only Athens had it for more than some other city-states for 200 years. It was born and died there. If we apply the four criteria of democracy, now, why other countries use it, it's a different story. But let me give you a definition of democracy. I use only ancient sources. The first definition comes from Pericles. Pericles, by the way, resembles very much to Donald Trump. You're not gonna believe, no, I'm not kidding. You're not gonna believe it. Pericles was famous, he was a demagogue. He was a populist. He would say everything to please the people. He would suggest increasing the salaries, and he did it, and the wages. That should ring a bell. So exactly if you see Donald Trump's program or non-program, you can copy-paste it from Pericles. Pericles, no, I'm not kidding at all, because being a demagogue doesn't mean that you cannot be competent. Because the guy, Pericles, wants to become president. But this didn't prevent him to build the Parthenon. Actually, he didn't build the Parthenon. He stole the money from all the other the city states. He taxed the rich, and then he built the Parthenon. Because he had a girlfriend called Aspasia, and she wanted the Parthenon. That's the true story. Pausanias, 400 years after his glory, said he was such a demagogue that he put Thucydides, not the historian, someone else, that he said once the Spartan leader, Archidamus, he said to him, look, how good is he in demagogue? You're not going to believe this, how good is he. When we fight in the palestra, in the wrestling room, and I put him down, and I beat him, he's able to persuade all the audience that he won. So it's amazing, says that, how demagogue. But maybe Trump is a demagogue, but after all, he can be good for the United States. It's time to see. But let me give you another thing about clue about Donald Trump. If ostracism was allowed in the United States, ostracism was a policy in ancient Athens that any citizen can go to the Ecclesia of Vimus, that the General Assembly of ancient Athenians, and say, I don't like David Wick, and I like him to ostracize it for 10 years. So people, it was the only secret vote, there was some other, but the only secret vote. People can vote, and then say, if he got the majority, then he can be ostracized, because he's dangerous to the Athens system. So we can ostracize him, we can have a vote. And of course, many great men of antiquity, unlike not very pleased though, were ostracized. And this, but if we had the same policy in the United States, most probably with the same vote, Donald Trump, instead of being president of the United States, he would be ostracized. 10 years as being dangerous to that. So this, just as a motivation, as I said to David before, I'm not in favor of democracy. For the same reasons that Plato and John Stuart Mill was against democracy. And you are not in favor of democracy if you see what democracy requires. A definition. Pericles gave an unfortunate definition of democracy. Our political system is named democracy because the many and not the few rule. This is confusing because a lot of people took that means majority voting. It's not majority voting. It's majority voting if all citizens participate. It's not majority voting of the parliament, for example. So to have democracy, you require a majority vote of Ecclesia of Vimus, the General Assembly of People. And this is the difference between today's and ancient art. Actually, Sparta, that everybody hates, was more representative democracy than today's democracy. The parliament in Sparta, Ephori, was, by majority vote, elected by the General Assembly. Exactly the same thing that we have today, called Appella, the General Assembly. Exactly the same thing that we have today with the representative democracy. I think the best definition was given by Aristotle. Maybe he has more things, but I want to just point this. In a democracy, all citizens participate. When they participate, they decide and they vote. And this is fine, so how? Now, there are four criteria that I'll discuss below why the ancient Athenian system of democracy is different from today's political system, which I don't want to call it democracy. So as such, as I said, it's a unique system that was born in ancient Athens and died for the 200 years from 5th century and 4th century BCE. That's a strong argument, but anyway, I don't have time to now to explain it. My point here is that the contemporary political systems, they use the word democracy. Any dictator can use the word democracy. People's Republic, for example, Republic is an intellect, but democracy, or representative democracy, or indirect democracy, or real democracy. You will see how many adjectives they use to show that they are not democracy. Because if it's democracy, you don't have to use any adjective. Either you are or you are not. There are quantitative and qualitative differences, and the latter, the qualitative differences, they are very important. Now, I'm an optimist, and I use the myth of Pandora's box, and I say today that we have the technology, internet and social media is an excellent technology that we can use to re-engineering democracy. So people can participate. But as John Stuart Mill said, I don't want all people to participate. I like people that they have gnosis and areti. That means that they have knowledge and virtue. And when someone asked me, what do you mean, Gregory, by areti, by virtue? It's very easy. If someone crosses a red line, he doesn't have a virtue. He should not be allowed to vote and be elected. So it's very easy today to see who has grown up. I know it's a strong argument, but if you violate the laws, how can you then run for office? Socrates taught us one thing, even though the court that sentenced him to death was a very good court. It was the Aegea. It was a huge court. And rightly so, he was condemned to death for the reasons that I can explain. But he violated the law. I mean, a lot of people do not accept what I say. Of course, Socrates had the choice to leave, to escape, in other words. But he says, as a citizen, I have to obey the law. And that's why maybe he remained for many others. So I think we have here, Pandora's box is not empty. There are a lot of promises that they have invented this beautiful technology of internet and social media. Right now, what I'm saying, for example, all the world can see it. And that's, you cannot do that just 50 years or 30 years or 20 years ago. This is very important. So the issues can be debated and people can vote. And of course, we need atlases. Atlases, you know, this guy that in his shoulder, all the earth, that's related to peace. So we have to have a stability. We have to have an environment so we are not shaking as a globe, as a world. And this is a political decision. So. Someone had, and by the way, democracy in no country in the world was implemented by democratic means. In ancient Athens was the case. In England was the case in the 16th century. The American War of Independence is the case. The French Revolution is the case. All of them, they say they lead to democracy, but with violent means. So that's a story that we can debate after we finish the conference. Now, the four criteria, and I finish with the first part. It's not they are not mine, by the way. There's nothing mine here. I have to just warn you that when you use the word, we have some incidents in the past. When you use the word, I discovered this. This is the first time that is said. If you hear some noises coming from this side, something like a laugh, something like, you know, the earth is trembling. Over there is the old cemetery of Athens. Great men are there. And when they hear these words, you know, they start laughing in their graves. So be careful when you say in Athens that this is the first time that ever this time. So it's you have to be very careful. And so that's why I'm saying, no, that's not the first time. You know, you have to keep the dead. I don't believe in resurrection of the dead, so I want to leave them there. You never know what's happened. So this is the four criteria. Isonomy, I think they're all in this world. Isonomy, isotelia, isigoria, isoifosy. They're all in the English Oxford Dictionary. So they're all English words, even though they come from Greek. But anyway, every citizen must be equal before the law. This implies protection from corrupt judges. Doesn't mean only that you're, and of course, the rich can hire shrewd lawyers. You don't have isonomy if you have the courts that here in Greece, for example, the court is only one judge. In the United States, they say, he's corrupt. In ancient Athens, at least, they solved this problem by having thousands of judges. So it was very difficult to corrupt them. And of course, lawyers, they were not allowed to enter the court. But they can write a speech for the different clients that they have. But I think, I want to be fair, my judgment is that pretty much the Western world, United States, Europe, they do very well in terms of isotopy. I mean, it's not that the big gap, it's not there. Second is isotopy. That means that all citizens must be taxed according to their ability, income, wealth. But if you read the ancient documents, isotopy means other things as well. It means a negative income tax, we call it in economics. People should be subsidized to participate in democracy. I know it's very controversial. Not only that, people should subsidize to get education so they can be able to participate in democracy. And that's the thing about free education. What is the purpose of free education? In ancient Athens, for example, the rich only can have a private educator, still they have today in Athens. And of course, they can go and organize symposiums like this one. Symposium in ancient Athens meant many things. First, someone, a philosopher, in his house, in a rich man's house, can invite 20, 30 people, 50 people, and then they have a discussion with drinking, symposium. We drink together, that's what it means. So that's what we have here, actually. We have a symposium here, because I'm not gonna give you wine, I give you only water. Tonight I'll give you wine, otherwise it's gonna be in disarray, the whole conference. We have somehow to normalize. And of course, I'm not gonna give some other extras that ancient symposiums have, and I don't want to mention, because beyond my morality. Now, of course, this is, again, I should say that the advanced countries in the world today, they are doing very well in terms of ISO data. Do we have a good, not a perfect, tax system? You cannot have a perfect tax system, everybody will complain. Don't forget that the reason or the excuse, if you want, that we have the American Revolution of independence was because of taxes. Can you imagine what would happen to the United States if they were not taxed? If the British were thoughtful enough to understand that taxing is something that they can get money in different ways rather than taxing. But anyway, now, there's no much difference between modern states, modern democracies, income and wealth tax, and ancient Africa. But there are two other criteria, and I'll finish with that. They are very important. And this is very, because it defines the substance, the crux of the matter. Isigoria means the freedom to speak. Everybody says the freedom to speak. Actually, the freedom of press. Let me give you a hypothesis. The stronger is the freedom of press, the less democracy you have. If you have democracy, you don't need freedom of the press. Because freedom of speech only in front of the body which decides on all the issues of the politia. That's the ecclesia of him. You have the freedom to speak in front of a body. I give you as a democracy, the freedom to speak, where they're going to decide not only what to do, the laws, but at the same time who's going to rule. Why you need the freedom of the press, or the so-called? Why you need people to speak in front of a body that does not decide and does not rule? Children are involved in the freedom of press. Children do not vote, but they're victims of what we can call freedom of press. And of course, it's defined negatively. They say lack of censorship. This is an important issue, but isigoria, on the contrary, it implies that you should not speak in front of a body that does not decide. Socrates, that's why he was condemned to death, because he was talking in front of the youth, and he was not allowed to talk. That's why he was corrupted, the youth. There are other people's responsibility, and of course they must have ethos, arete, virtue, those that they are the pedagogy, those that they are the educators to speak in front. They should be certified to speak in front of young people starting from the elementary school. Not anybody can go and speak and teach and educate students before their university level. There are strict criteria in some countries, but the press can talk to anybody. And this is a problem. Now, isocracy also must have the same problem. This is an idea that if you have good citizens, if you have knowledge citizens, why you need elections? You draw. You have 1 million people in the United States that can become good presidents. So you put them in a box, you draw the one, and that's the best one. And they serve one for 1 year. At least that's what was done in the United States. I'll stop here. My argument is, and I have a paper after I brainstorm with you, I'll upload it. My idea is that these two criteria, no modern state meets it, and therefore, for this reason, we should not call them democracies. The fathers of the American Federation, they were very smart, if I'm not mistaken. They say, we don't like to adopt the ancient Athens system of democracy because it's chaotic. It's not stable. We're gonna adopt the republic system of organizing our politia, of our states, and of course that was in ancient Rome. that a lot of American thinkers of the 19th century, and non-Americans, like Tocqueville, for example, the French one, they praise the American system as being a democracy, as being inspired by ancient democracy. Welcome to Athens. Now the Athens Institute for Education and Research is not an institute. A lot of people confuse us, and they write in the social media, they write in the press that they are not an institute. Well, we are not, we are an association. So we say that, we write that, we are an association, a world association of academic research. In other words, don't confuse us with MIT. Both were use the name of institute. The same thing that they use the word democracy in so many other countries, as I said. We use the word institute, and there is a reason for that. I'll spare the details. The reason is very simple, because it gives the opportunity to our members that they come from outside to come and hold a sabbatical here. So they can bring research funds. Because if you are an association, this is very difficult. But in essence, we're an association. Currently, we have 2,200 members coming from 115 countries. And this is our idea. Our idea goes back to Pericles' funeral oration, Thucydides, actually, that says, our city is open to the world. We never expel a foreigner from learning or seeing. And I have the ancient Greek quote. So we are open to the world. People can come here, they can say anything they like. And of course, we don't vote, we don't decide, but they are free to speak. And they have so many people coming from all over the world. Now, the way that we organize it is the ancient idea of a symposium, small groups. You know, we cannot, and we do not want to organize big conferences. We cannot, and we do not want. So all our symposiums, all our conferences are small. If a conference grows large, then we chop it. We bring it into smaller parts. So you can see a lot of parallel events. But a conference for us is good if you have 25 to 50 participants. Then you require a second parallel room. So we don't want more than that. So this is the reason why, first, we grow, we have more and more conferences. Second, all our conferences kept small. And this is the idea because it gives you an obligation, not present and run. So you will meet people here from different countries, and hopefully, if you like what we are doing, you would be willing to come again. Now, so this is our concept. Bad or good, we have a mission, we have a policy. Believe it or not, we are doing what we are promising, what we are saying, 99%, because there are some factors that can diverge you. But our mission is there, very difficult can be changed, because that's the original idea. And of course, we have policies, because if we don't have policies, we don't have rules, we don't have laws, then this is not an organization. Now, as I said, our mission is to provide a forum where academics and researchers can come from all over the world and exchange ideas. This is the reason why your abstract is not so important, but you are very important. So what we are going to say for 50 minutes, including the current speaker, is not important. What is important is your interaction with other scholars, because there are around the world much better and relevant conferences with thousands of participants than this one. We are here for a different mission. I mean, this is our idea. Now, some facts. As I said, we have 2,200 members. We have 6,000 academics from 150 countries here volunteer their service to help with reviewing. This is a story I'll come because it's a painful one. We have published 200 books from 865 authors, and 20,000 academics here present papers to one or more conferences organized by ITNR since 1995. So we've been around for 22 years. Now, basic activities in order to meet our mission, as I said, discussions on this, some research, external funding, hosting visiting researchers, publication, and now this year, as you saw, we start and hopefully we'll have more summer courses. Always, whatever we are doing is because members and friends demand. So if you come and ask us as a friend or as a member, let's do that, we see, as long as you don't ask for my time, my money, we can do it. And you are willing to spend some time, we can do it. Publications, now, this is the pain, and I have to explain very well. First of all, in the beginning, we didn't want to publish. This is because it's not in our mission. We don't want but because there are thousands of publications around the world. So you can come present your paper here, present in another conference, and then send it to a better journal, send it to a better book. We didn't want to publish, but unfortunately we were forced to consider it because a lot of our members and friends said, if you don't have this outlet, we cannot come. Because most of our participants, they get money from their universities. So we are forced to start publishing. Now what we publish now is an abstract book. This is important as well. This is a lot of people, they don't want other people, they see and they ask for your presentation. If you allow us, we upload your presentation. And you'll be surprised how many people might receive emails. Because they see it and they say, okay, because it goes to Google, and then they see that presentation, then they ask you for more information on the paper. Online papers, this is, we review this. We have books, which is collection of books from various conferences, and that's an idea. For example, since we organize many conferences, it is quite possible to collect 20 papers from different conferences that made up a specific theme, ancient law, for example, or plate, or whatever, or, we have published many books. They are very thematic, even though all our conferences are non-thematic. So this is an idea. So that's why we say we don't publish paper book proceedings per se, because it can grow. Now, this is the problem, the e-journals. 3 years ago, we started 15 journals. It's a lot of work. Personally, I didn't want to do e-journals, even though they are cheap because we don't print them. It's a lot of work in terms of editors. We have very good editors. In terms of reviewers, it's a lot of work. And I approached private companies if they wanted to publish the journal for us. It's a problem. They want a lot of money. Just for one journal, they request 80,000 euros just to put their name without doing anything. We'll do all their work. So this is a problem, and this has created a lot of, because it's very difficult to get an impact factor, because you have to develop the journal. Most of our journals are 3 years or 2 years old. Fortunately, some of the journals now, and we have a lot of papers because of the conference, they try to do, we want to index, and your help will be more than welcome on this. I have some good news and bad news about that, but still we're working because it needs at least 5 years of publication and to establish a journal. But a lot of people, a lot of members, they asked it, so we deliver monographs, we don't do that anymore. Now, if you like what we are doing, maybe you don't, that will be the 5% or 1%. If you like what we are doing, you can join us. Now, there is no cost if you want to become a member. Of course, this is not a problem. We have a fixed cost on purpose, because we want to do face control. We don't like to have people coming just for coming. So it's not free to enter and become a member. But once you came on your own to one of our conferences, and you like, see what's going to happen till tomorrow night, if you like what we are doing, then you can join it. If you don't like it, you can suggest how we can improve, but without changing our mission. And our mission states clearly, we want people, academics from all over the world. Don't say, I don't want this professor from an unknown university, from an unknown country, because he doesn't do good research. This is not acceptable. It means we want this guy to come and present his work. Doesn't mean that he's going to get published. I forgot to say that the acceptance rate of our journals is 25%. This year we had 1,600 pages submitted. 1,600. And we accept about, this year I mean 2016, and we accept about 300. So you can calculate that the rate is very low, but that doesn't mean that we have reached a high level of quality. Okay. Still we have to work on it. Now, organize a panel for one of our future conferences. Now if you really like what you are doing, the second thing is if you organize a panel, we create a website. This responds to the criticism, a valid criticism, that conferences, all our conferences are non-thematic, they are general. But if you really want to contribute, then 10 members, they can organize thematic conferences. We have some examples, like Plato, for example. We have some examples in this conference. So if you have more and more within this broad area, and this is very good because you bring audience outside your own area. Because if you organize something about Plato, a symposium on Plato only, you will have 30 speakers, they speak about Plato and nothing else. Nobody else hears them. But if you have a panel within this general audience and talk about Plato, then a lot of people hear that are outside the area. And that's the added value. I'm not saying that this is good or bad. I'm not taking value judgment. I'm saying that this is an additional benefit that you can get from this one. So please, if you feel, David Wick, the director of our Arts and Humanities Research Division, I'll explain about our organization later, he will be here and I'll be here. So if you really want to discuss with him how to organize a panel, we have a policy. You will see it, and more than you want. But if you submit papers for publication, that we need work, we need good reviewers, it's a lot of work, and we need prompt reviewers. So if they say they'll finish it by the end of 2017, they don't misspell it, and they mean 71. So it's important that you finish within the time period, because the other academics will. We don't really care. Personally, I care only about the reputation, but for your paper, the other academics, they're gonna push, say, hey, what happened? And it's all blind review. And by the way, I should say that there is no processing or publication fee. We don't get any money because some people allege otherwise. We don't get any money if you want to publish, but does not guarantee the publication. Good professors have been rejected, so because it's a real blind review, and I have no involvement whatsoever. Nobody has an involvement. We have an independent process, and we follow. We have a plagiarism software that checks, first of all, you've never published anywhere else. And we follow all the standards. And of course, all now we need better papers to submit. And by the way, for the e-journals, we allow external submissions. Because that's the only way that we can improve the quality. So we have papers now published from very good professors and promising professors from top universities around the world. But still, we need a lot of work to do on that. Organize a summer visiting course, I already mentioned that. Today's activity, now I'm going into the third part and the last before I finish my opening remarks. Now let me say a little bit about our organization because I don't have it there. We're organized into research units because it's similar to a department. And a lot of people, they want. So we give the opportunity everybody to participate and rule. So you don't see photographs of the president, the vice president, of on our website. You see only, you know, policies, missions, information. So we are not. I don't like it to put pictures and these fancy things. Some other people like it. But anyway, we're organized in 7 research divisions, if I'm not mistaken, and about 40 research units. The idea was very simple. If someone, we start with one conference, then say, okay, why don't we organize a conference on health or a conference on philosophy? Right away, we have to create a union for that. And right away, someone had to head that. So if you see the heads and the directors of the unions and the researchers, you can get a feeling who is who. They're all from all over the world. And from good and not so good universities. And from good and not so good cadres, if you want. But we like this mixture. But all their academics, all their research, all they teach the youth of the world, because this is our criteria, and this is very important. It doesn't matter if he's not a good researcher, because you don't approve his paper, but don't forget, hopefully, he will get something here and brings to his own country, to his students, to his colleagues. And that's our motivation of doing what we are doing. Now, we have some rules, chairpersons, David Wick. Usually they don't follow the rules, because you know how to manage professional people is like to herd stray cats. It's impossible. I mean, we have the rules. Please follow them. If you are chairing a session, you don't comment on the papers presented. Because it's an old dilemma. Who is going to guard the guardians? As a chair, what you do, you monitor time, nothing else. And of course, the discussion after. But if you start debating with the participants, who's going to control you, the chair? But if you have this inside tendency to talk no matter what, please ask Olga to relieve you from this duty. Okay? So please, if you cannot chair without interrupting the and coming on the papers, please ask to be changed. So this is very important for us because we had some problems in the past. Now, for technical assistance, conduct administration, let me introduce you. Now, if you prefer men, because you see, you are an ancient Athens. Now, Kostas is there. Kostas comes. So he, don't ask me or anybody else. He's good for administration. If you prefer women, Olga is here. So we give you preferences. Whatever you prefer, you can ask. Because some people have agoraphobia. I say it in English, it's a Greek word and very few people understand, so it's good because it has some moral connotation. So, in any case, so you ask them whatever you could administrate. Not me, not David Witt, because even if we know, we should not answer it. Because we might be a source of misinformation. And then you call us. So 10 minutes coffee break between sessions. We don't put in the problem because we don't overflow the problem. So the chair knows that has to finish 10 minutes. I think we have a lot of time for discussion. Now, we have three, I want to call it educational activities. They are not. We have the urban walk. It's very good tomorrow in the morning. We have a Delphi visit, if I'm not mistaken, on Thursday, and a cruise on Friday. We never, by the way, canceled an event with two exceptions. It was during this period, about some years ago, because of the Aeolus. You cannot go against Aeolus. Aeolus was the god of the wind. So if we have problems with the wind, with the god, we're not going to do the cruise. The forecast is okay so far. Enjoy the conference. Thank you very much for being here. Sorry for taking my time. Because actually we still have 5 minutes, usually I finish earlier. I'll give the floor now to David Wick, our Director of the Arts and Humanities, to say a few words if he wants to, and chair the first session. Just the first session, all 5 speakers are here. Okay, thank you very much.